only thing I knew about South America when I arrived in Peru was to be on the lookout for revolutions. Luckily, things seem pretty calm in Lima at the moment. They've just elected a new president, and he'll be given a honeymoon period of a month or two before people start grumbling again. So, life goes on as normal for the time being. Breakfast and coffee only. Today we shall be going from sea level up to 16,000 feet. And if you're not used to that altitude, you should keep your stomach quiet and very empty. Normally I live at 200 feet in Notting Hill. Better than sea level, but not quite altitude training. Until 10 years ago, the railways were run by the British, which is why the train always leaves on time, unlike most things in Peru. The odd thing is that the ticket office opens only an hour or so before the train leaves, and you can only buy tickets on the day you're travelling. So there's a certain tension in the queue, and I have an extra problem. Will my O-level Spanish be good enough to buy the right ticket?
Pues, un callo. Una persona primera clase.
Un callo, ¿no?
Un callo.
This last-minute rush means that you could get here early and still be queuing when the train left. And if that happened, you'd have to come back tomorrow, because there's only one train. At 7:40 in the morning, Lima Station locks up for the day. The mist lies heavy on Lima for 9 months of the year, a depressing, dead, grey onshore mist. Not a morning mist, but an all-day blanket. I've never met a seaside town before. You have to go inland to find the sun. Inland and up, waiting and waiting for that moment when you slide out into the sunshine. Our destination, 200 miles away, is Huancayo, in the heart of the Andes. It takes nearly 10 hours at an average speed of 23 miles an hour, and yet the cost of a ticket is just £2. 10 hours is a long time, so people eat or read the time away or just stare out of the window at the same old Andes as usual. What I'd like to do, if my Spanish is up to it, is meet some of the natives. As it turned out, it was a good job I spoke English.
To Huancayo.
I am, yes. And what do you do in Peru?
I'm a businessman.
And what sort of a businessman
do you? Oh, I kind of sell all kinds of things. Who can I take bras, ships, needles?
Who do you sell ships to?
Well, I try to sell them to the Navy. I haven't yet sold my first ship, but when I do, that'll be the great day. I can go and say, yesterday I sold a ship.
Finally, the mist of Lima begins to thin, and ahead we can just see the outline of the distant Andes. The engine hoots the whole time. At crossings, at houses, at tunnels, dogs, cats, almost at random. This is because on Peruvian railways there's no such thing as a trespasser. The locals use the track as their very own private path.
Pero la novia,
Of course, this line wasn't built to ferry Indians up and down the Andes. It was built because there is huge mineral wealth way up in the mountains. And before the trains came, the only way of getting the minerals down was by mule. The mines still rely absolutely on the railway. In fact, the railway wouldn't even carry ordinary, unprofitable people if the government didn't insist on having one passenger train a day. Good old Peruvian government, I say. The men who built this railway must have felt sometimes they were exploring a new and hostile planet. They had to survey 20 or more miles ahead of the work in case they were heading up a blind valley. And some bits were so inaccessible that engineers had to be lowered on a rope down the cliff face to spy out the land. It was the only way they could get a look at the possible line of progress. Bridge, one of an amazing series of bridges and tunnels which stand as a monument to the man who built this railway over 100 years ago, Henry Meigs. Don Enrique, as they called him, was an American and had the necessary brashness and dynamism to do the impossible, as well as the ability to bribe and corrupt when necessary. "Where a llama can go," he said, "I can take a railway. If there is no other way of getting through, I will suspend the line from a balloon." He didn't need balloons, as it happens. What he did need was 66 tunnels, 61 bridges, and millions of tons of explosives. To make it harder, the men who built the railway were constantly being struck down by disease. Over 2,000 of them died. They were a mixed bunch, tough desperados from Chile, ex-slaves from Africa, cheap Chinese labor. And they were constantly battling against floods, landslides, earthquakes, and shortage of money. But the railway always bounced back. There was, after all, no other way of getting to the top. The grade from top to bottom is over 6%, but they couldn't take trains up a slope of more than 4%. The solution? Zigzags, an old Inca idea for getting up hills. Whenever the line came to somewhere too steep, they simply gained height by going backwards, then forwards again. It was primitive, and it slowed trains down, but it worked. It still works today. It may seem strange to sit in a train and suddenly find yourself going backwards, but it's nice to know that in a moment you'll be going forward again, a few hundred feet above this exact spot. Feel you're in the Andes now, climbing hard and clinging to the mountain by the skin of your teeth, wondering what there is to stop you falling off. Occasionally trains do fall off onto the rocks below. More often it's rocks that fall onto the train. But today you feel the Andes are for once on our side, willing us to get to the top. When you're at 12,000 feet, the air gets pretty thin. If you live here, like the Indians, you get polycythemia, which is a fancy way of saying that you develop many more of the red corpuscles in your blood which carry oxygen. And that's why so many Indian children have apparently bonny red cheeks shining through their brown skin. But if you're up here for the first time, the blood reacts to the shortage of oxygen by racing round your veins much faster. Or you can simply accept the free oxygen on offer from the charming stewardess. Trains need oxygen too. A few years ago, this line was all steam, 1300 horsepower engines, but they were replaced one day by diesel engines of the same power. Progress. The only thing was that the new diesels couldn't get up the mountain. Nobody could make out why until it was realized that the diesel process needs more air. So they had to buy more diesels of 3000 horsepower to replace steam engines of 1300. That's progress? At last, my first real native, and one that I know won't laugh at my O-level Spanish. Unfortunately, it turns out she doesn't speak O-level Spanish. She only speaks fluent Spanish, a language I'm unacquainted with. Very near the top now, and people are getting so excited that they're reading the paper, scratching themselves, or simply fast asleep with the thrill of it all. Well, I don't mind making a fool of myself. I think it's breathtaking. It's as high than I've ever been before in my life, except in a plane, and that doesn't count as life. Here, on the roof of the world, where the mountains begin to flatten out, as if exhausted from the climb, what can you say, except, wish you were here. The highest passenger railway in the world. 3 miles high, 4 Ben Nevises. Most helicopters couldn't even get up here. It's almost too high to take in. And just over the top at La Raya, the highest chimney in the world, belching the smoke of mining and smelting into the pure Andean air. And for a third world record, the world's highest polluted river, the Mantaro. Any fish born in this river would have a life expectancy of about 10 seconds. It takes Peru's industrial waste and sends it slowly down to the jungle, a brown, dead, disgusting present from the Peruvians to the Brazilians, a wicked fairy to attend at the birth of the baby River Amazon. After a traveling salesman and a nun, I add to my collection a German electronic engineer, taking a year off to do South America. And what was he going to do when he got off this train?
So I'm going to do some backpacking in Peru.
Ah, the backpacking. I wish I had done it.
Going up Inca Trail?
I'm not sure. I'm having second thoughts about it.
Why?
Well, there's zillions of people walking that trail.
Even in Peru, you have to get away from tourists.
Yeah, but my kind of travel is further down in the jungle or further away, off the beaten track. But sometimes you can't avoid it. I mean, this is a one-way street.
Uh-huh.
Yamitas.
Adorno.
Uh-huh.
These are Peruvians I can actually communicate with. They're off to Huancayo to buy llamas. Llamas? Oh, toy llamas. They want to know how old my children are, what they're called, whether they might like a toy llama as a present. Just girl talk, you know.
Yo tengo.
The sun is going down now, and so are we, down to Huancayo, through valleys of maize and eucalyptus trees. At last, bottom sore, we get out in Huancayo. The English local brochure says, mysteriously, that the town has almost 12 good hotels. And they've all sent touts, it seems.
If you want, you can go to our office. It's on Real Street. No, it's very comfortable.
I want to go to Ayacucho, but how long does it take to go to Ayacucho?
Yeah, the trip is 12 hours.
Oh,
yeah.
It's long.
Yeah.
Okay.
If you want, we have a bus to the tourist hotel too.
No, I think I'll walk.
Huancayo reminds me of what a Wild West frontier town must have been like, except that here they've got buses instead of stagecoaches, and the names are rather more Spanish than Dodge City and Wyoming. It doesn't surprise me to learn that one of the most popular crimes locally is cattle stealing. Personally, I'd like to see a law against shaving with intent to cause grievous bodily harm. I'm trying not to give anything away in my expression, but this man is no threat to Vidal Sassoon. He uses cold water for shaving. He's perfected a way of making razors blunt. And for breakfast this morning, he had raw onions. All I need now is a shave. New dawn, and time to move on down the line, pushing deeper and deeper into the Andes, where European clothes and faces become rarer, a reminder that the Spaniards were always in the minority, and we gringos still are. If Huancayo is a frontier town, then now we're going deep into Indian territory. Through all the smell of cooking, the smell of coffee, the unmistakable fragrance of 500 crowded Indians, comes one smell I haven't had in my nostrils for 15 years, steam. For a mere 80p, I've bought myself 10 hours of travel behind a British-built Hunslet 280 made way back in 1936. I'll be surprised if I get a seat now, but on this little train, it doesn't really matter. Within those coaches, there's another world to explore. I'll say one thing for llamas. If you've got one, it breaks the ice quickly with the natives. These ones seem to be talking a very strange form of Spanish, and I really can't make out a word. But it doesn't stop us making friends.
No comprendo.
No. Oh, no.
I've just realized that in English trains, the passengers perch gingerly in their seats, knowing they're not there for very long. But Peruvians settle down from the word go, as if installed in a new home.
Paco, es una palabra quechua?
They're not talking Spanish at all. They're talking Quechua, the language left behind by the Incas.
Llama castellano.
Llama vaca.
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 All along the line, there are stations waiting for the one big event in their little lives, the daily arrival of the train.
Hello, Banca Velica. Recibe un telegrama. Llegaría fecha 36, señor jefe de estación, Banca Velica. Fecha 2-05-80, se recibió documento de dicho despacho guía 64-86-91.
We've been going 4 or 5 hours now, with another 5 or 6 to come, at a leisurely speed which makes you feel part of the landscape rather than cut off from it. For an Englishman, it's a rare treat to stand outside on a train without feeling an imminent danger of death. Now I know why Butch Cassidy found train holdups so easy. Another unexplained stop. Well, all stops are unexplained in Peru. People just wait around till things start happening again. What's happening now is that they're taking our engine away. No, they're not. They're just changing it. Thank God for that.
Thank you. gracias.
Time for lunch. And the only way to get lunch is to buy all the courses separately. A do-it-yourself lunch kit.
¿Cuánto? 60.
Gracias.
This engine is a Baldwin, made in Philadelphia, USA in 1920. 1920 is the year this narrow gauge line was built, and that means that the engine pulling us today was pulling trains the very day the line opened. And it's going to take us up the last hard climb to Huancavelica, where the Spaniards discovered quicksilver hundreds of years ago at the height of their empire. Now the last gentle entry through the flat back streets of Huancavelica. Though you'd think the train was climbing Everest to look at it. Perhaps that's why steam engines are different from any other kind. They're all ham actors at heart. The line wasn't really meant to come here at all. It was meant to go to Ayacucho, the town down the main valley. But the man in charge of building the line was a native of Huancavelica, and, well, the line went sideways to Huancavelica. But you can tell they were proud of it because it's the only line in Peru that wasn't built by an American or the British. It's Peruvian through and through. I've already come to the firm decision that I like the Peruvians. For one thing, they're so relaxed. But here, things seem too relaxed. Nothing's happening at all in Huancavelica. Even mañana seems to be a dirty word. Who wants to do anything tomorrow? There'll be plenty of time. So, it's a major excitement when a foreigner is seen writing a postcard. And what else to send a card of? Llamas. If rustling goes on round here, it would have to be llama rustling, though I'm not sure why anyone would want to steal one. Llamas are surly, bad-tempered beasts. They're not strong enough to carry a man. Their milk is undrinkable, and their meat and wool are no great shakes. It's usually said that the one great failing of the Inca Empire was not having the wheel. I think it was not having horses or cows, only llamas. The railway stops at Huancavelica. From here, it's a three-day bus journey across some of the most exciting, that is, some of the worst roads in Peru, to the beginning of the Southern Railway and the famous city at its railhead. Cuzco, the ancient capital of the Incas. Of all the great civilizations in Peru, the Incas were the mightiest and the most efficient, conquering and ruling from the sea to the jungle over 1,000 miles of the Andes. When the Spaniards arrived here in 1533, they found Cuzco the Inca showpiece. the center of a teeming empire, perhaps like the Roman Empire. Perhaps, others think, more like the Soviet Empire. But 50 miles from here, hidden in the mountains, lies something the Spaniards never found. Machu Picchu, the forgotten city of the Incas. What the Spanish never stumbled across in 300 years was discovered in 1911 by a 36-year-old Yale professor called Hiram Bingham. When he crawled his way to the top, he found it covered in jungle with just two Indian farmers scratching a living from it, the descendants of the Incas. Today, the Indians come and go as porters. The true owners and invaders now are the tourists.
Y justamente vamos a tener la oportunidad de ver que por este lado, en la parte inferior, está el río, una muralla de defensa. Y por el otro lado tenemos el precipicio. Que conecta y en unos 7-8 días puede comunicarse con el Cusco y viceversa.
Welche innerhalb von 8 Tagen mit Cusco die direkte Verbindung schafft.
Justamente ahora vamos a tener la
oportunidad. We made our way into an untouched forest, wrote Bingham. Suddenly I found myself confronted with the walls of ruined houses built of the finest quality Inca stonework. It was hard to see them, for they were partly covered with trees and moss, the growth of centuries, but hiding in bamboo thickets appeared, here and there, walls of white granite, carefully cut and exquisitely fitted together. Dimly, I began to realize that these walls and temples were as fine as the finest stonework in the world. Machu Picchu must be the only city in the world, lost or otherwise, which is accessible by railway alone. There is no road of any kind. But to get here at all, even for tourists, is an achievement. They have to be flown up the day before from sea level to Cusco at 11,000 feet. They get a few hours to adjust to altitude, then a lightning tour of Cusco, up at crack of dawn the next day to catch the early train for a 3-hour journey, round Machu Picchu for the experience of a lifetime, then back into the train again. You'd get the same feeling going on an outing to Westminster Abbey, if Westminster Abbey were on the top of Snowdon. No wonder they've collapsed. Short of sleep and oxygen, stuffed full of facts, they've taken the line of least resistance. Perhaps they'll wake up later and wonder if they've just dreamt Machu Picchu.
The next carriage but one, the 14 Japanese, all fast asleep.
Well, they are everywhere.
Well, the Germans are everywhere too.
No, I found very little Germans in Peru.
Really?
I think 80% are French.
French?
Yes.
10% Americans.
We noticed the train was very late coming from Machu Picchu this morning. You were on that train, were you?
Yes, were we ever.
Why was it so late?
Well, we were told by the taxi driver to be sure and be there at 7 o'clock because it always left on time. So we were there in time, you know, to leave. And at 7 o'clock, all six cars of the train were loaded with passengers, all ready for Machu Picchu. But at 7 o'clock, we didn't move, and we discovered that the train did not have an engine to it. We were informed that it would be a half an hour before an engine would be available. And finally, it was 2 hours before we actually started to move. But once we got rolling, it was okay.
I don't know if this is a rude question, but of all the tourists you have, do the different nationalities behave differently? I mean, can you tell a crowd of Germans from a crowd of Americans or French?
You know, English-speaking people have a special characteristic. They listen.
They listen? Who doesn't listen then?
Spanish-speaking people normally don't listen much.
And so back to Cuzco, the city that the Spanish had to take if they were to bring the Incas to their knees. The weary army that Pizarro brought was an army in name only. It was so small it could easily have fitted onto our train. They didn't have a train, of course, only horses, and not enough of them to go round. On the other hand, Pizarro's army never had to do Machu Picchu and back in the same day. The purpose of these ancient channels is not clear, says the guidebook. They may have been used to pour wine, or for the blood of sacrificial victims, or they may simply be genuine slides in which the children of the Incas could indulge in... Jack! Cuzco is a weird and wonderful mixture of European and native. The top half of many buildings is Spanish. The bottom half is ancient Inca stonework. The top half of their lives may be Roman Catholic, but deep down they still run the old beliefs. And many of the Catholic feasts are only disguised Indian festivals. Even the local cinema was unwittingly built by the Incas. Some of the most popular films there are not Western at all, but Chinese and Indian, as if the locals have some folk memory of their Asian origins. And what can they have made of the most famous Western folk hero of all, the god who was imported to replace all their old familiar gods? The painting of the Last Supper, which hangs in Cuzco Cathedral, looks at first sight like an ordinary classical painting. But look closer. There's something very unfamiliar about the main dish of the evening. It is, in fact, a speciality of Inca cuisine which was being cooked long before the Spanish came and which is still being eaten today. But to find it, I had to go far off the beaten tourist track. Dish of the day, for some people, is pork and corn. For others, it's a chunk off the Sunday joint. But my main course is still running around on the floor of the kitchen where it's lived all its life. The animal that the Incas considered such a delicacy was the humble guinea pig.
Mmm, it looks good.
I'd probably still be sitting there, wondering how to eat it, if I hadn't had a friendly Peruvian to show me how.
Mm.
I'm relieved to say that it doesn't actually taste too bad, a bit like gamey rabbit. It may seem outlandish to eat guinea pig, but I wonder what the Peruvians would make of our habit of eating nice little bunny rabbits. And what would they think of our even worse habit of eating frogs? A frog in Peru is just something you use in a pub game. This is one of the rarest of all sights in Peru, a spare engine going across Cusco from station to station. It's not the use of the line that's rare, it's the sight of the spare engine, because they normally use all the engines they've got. This particular engine is another old Baldwin, a prize for any Peruvian train spotter. There are, however, no train spotters in Peru. There being only 80 engines in the whole of Peru, a good train spotter would have all their numbers in a month. The Peruvians love to haggle, and if you accept their asking price, they look almost disappointed. Almost, not quite. The one thing they sometimes don't like is having their picture taken. The Indians often take it not as an invasion of privacy, but as an invasion of their soul. The one time I photographed a baby on her mother's back, the father approached me angrily and said, "Tu sacas su suerte, you're taking away her good luck," and cursed me briefly. Oddly, that photograph never came out. It was the only one on the roll that didn't. The Indian sellers come seldom to the big city. Most of their lives they spend in the tiny villages which dot the landscape for the next 200 miles south, right down to the edge of Bolivia. There isn't really much to tell one Indian village from the next, except sometimes the shape of the hats. Their forefathers were probably not the Incas so much as the people who were subject to the Incas, and life for them is still hard. The country is high and cold, and cultivation isn't easy. But they have self-sufficiency of a sort, growing their own food, weaving their own clothes, and even building their own houses. It came as a shock to Peru in the 1960s when General Velasco came to power. He was a full-blooded Indian and a left-winger. He promptly dispossessed the great landowners and gave their estates to the peasants so that they could cultivate the land of their own landlords and oppressors. But it didn't work. The Indians went on cultivating the little bit they needed. The rest went to rack and ruin. It only confirmed the suspicion that the Indians were very good at being peasants and craftsmen, but didn't make very good landlords. It was a far cry from the efficiency of the Inca Empire. Now runs dead south from Cusco, through this Inca heartland, to the end of Peru, another journey of about 10 hours long. All train journeys in Peru seem to be about 10 hours long. (Laughs) If you want to eat on a train in England, you go to the dining car. On Peruvian trains, there's no dining car. The waiter comes all the way to you. Well, that's fine if you're in the first coach or so, where the first class passengers are. But if you're at the other end of the train, 6 or 8 coaches away in second class, your food will be cold or spilt or lost. In any case, the locals in second class prefer to wait till the right station comes along.
One thing you can say for sure about the Peruvians is that they love eating. Eating snacks especially. They only have to set up a table, a bench, a stove, and hey presto, another restaurant is born.
Right at the front of the train is the only deluxe coach on the Peruvian railways, and the only bit of the train, funnily enough, not made in Sheffield. It's comfortable, full of varnish and leather, and if you sit up, you can just about see out of the window. And what you see is a plain, which in prehistoric times was covered by a huge lake. Now it's a cold, high plateau, on which nothing much thrives except woolly animals and potatoes. We're heading along, still at about 13,000 feet, towards Puno, where we'll arrive under cover of darkness. Nighttime, Puno, and ahead of us lies the remnants of that prehistoric lake, still over 100 miles of it. For once, our destination isn't a station, it's a quayside and a steamer. You won't find a steamer anywhere higher than this. Lake Titicaca is the highest navigable lake in the world at 12,500 feet. Also, an international frontier between Peru and Bolivia. The Atlanta was built in Hull in 1930 and rebuilt all over again in Puno. There was a scientific expedition here from Cambridge in 1937. I'm beginning to get the feeling that I'm in a little outpost of England, or England perhaps as it used to be, all varnished wood and polished brass. I'm in good hands tonight. Machinery from Gateshead. Personal hygiene by Shanks. Water purified by something from the Victoria and Albert Museum. Everything laid on to make sure that I get an early bed, so that I'll be up at the crack of dawn, ready to catch the sunrise. Thank you. We're in Bolivian waters now, land of Butch Cassidy and revolutions. They've had over a revolution a year ever since the country became independent. They've also fought several wars, and each time have lost territory. Once they had a seacoast. Now all they've got is half Lake Titicaca. But they're proud people, and the Bolivians still have a navy. For a lover of steam, this place is a paradise to stand and stare in. Not today, though, because we've been unofficially told that there's trouble brewing, and it'll be best to get through customs as quickly as possible. What kind of trouble? Nobody seems to know. All we know is that it's worth bribing your way onto the train to La Paz. The rail car is just big enough for half the passengers from the boat. Those of us who get onto it will be able to get to the capital, in safety, only 50 miles away. Those left behind will have to do the best they can. Somebody who's been listening to the radio says that the military have been putting out appeals for law and order. That's a sure sign that law and order is breaking down. But those who know the country say that things will be all right if we get through to La Paz.
We don't really get into trouble unless it was a really civil war, but if not, you just hear the next morning on the papers there's been a coup d'etat, what they call a golpe, and the military take over the government. But it never affects you really.
Well, yeah, we're traveling into a train in La Paz now, aren't we? Yeah. They say there's going to be a general strike at 3 o'clock and the military are going to come out.
Yeah. Well, let's hope we get there in time, because it would be very serious. Because they block the roads and sometimes the engines throw stones on the lorries and cars. Yeah.
And the trains as well?
I don't know about the trains, because it's the first time I'm traveling in train in Bolivia. But I hope that it will be the best for us to get back to La Paz in time.
Que está integrado por altos dirigentes de la Confederación de Fabriles, hace un llamado a todos los compañeros trabajadores, a todas las fuerzas revolucionarias, para que en ningún momento se dejen confundir por ciertos rumores.
Well, everyone's worst fears have been justified. The military have taken over, the workers have hit back with a call for a general strike. Sooner or later, the two sides are going to come to blows, and we're stuck in a one-horse town called Viacha. Well and truly stuck, because now a train has been derailed right in front of us. It could take hours to get it back on the line. We have to sit here waiting and waiting for something to happen. And if so, what? As I said, the one thing I knew about South America when I got here was to look out for revolutions. You're looking at one. Inside that rail car, there are 12 French tourists debating what to do next. They've just voted to stay put till they're rescued. But rescued by who? One thing I've learned is that when a train breaks down in South America, you don't wait for the next train or for the 7th Cavalry. You just carry on the best you can.
Mm-hmm.
Only 20 miles to La Paz, though it seems like 200. I just keep telling myself that La Paz, in Spanish, means peace. Thank you.